Welcome to Qt Widgets and More. In this episode, I will teach you how to do proper time travel. With your debugger, of course. Okay, with your debugger on Linux, using the debugger called RR. And by the way, Qt, this is Qt. Yes, it's Mozilla. I'll start this episode by dumping you straight into a scene of a crash. My dummy had gone 100 miles an hour and all of a sudden it met this wall of Q-fatal. At this stage, I would like to investigate the murder scene. And I can do that by going up my backtrace and I can see that, so this function down here with the Q-fatal, it actually was called from here. I had my model that called a parent with an index and another parent. At this stage in my investigation, it would be nice if I could go back in time to just the point before my parent method, or this parent method here, was called, so I could see what it did inside there, because obviously it was producing some result that I didn't expect. But with a normal debugger, that is not possible. What I can do, of course, is I can set a breakpoint on this line here, and then I start my application again. And when I hit this, well, I hit this 200,000 times. Okay, 200 times before the incident that actually produces the wrong result. So, that's not that easy. Okay, I can go out of the scope here. It's in a for loop, inside a for loop. I can put a breakpoint here instead. And then I can look at, when I'm at this the third time around, then I go in here and some more breakpoints. You've done that number of times. And then you end up here saying, continue. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, that was a 27. Now I will step into because I'm at the right state. Fortunately, RR is a debugger that allows me to go back in execution and investigate what did that call to parent look like. Let me show you. You remember that movie from, I believe, 2000 called Memento? This was this guy that couldn't remember much and, well, never mind. Excellent movie. If you haven't watched it, definitely worthwhile. A movie recommendation. I will record this Memento style and I'll show you what it looks like when you have set everything up. And then after that, I'll tell you how to set things up so that you can debug reverse. Okay. I started the debugger again, this time using RR. And to make it work, I need to go up here and choose Muse Debugger Lock, which will give me some additional stuff here. In that part of my screen now, I will issue command directly to the debugger because even though Qt Creator has support for reverse debugging using GDB, it doesn't support RR, which would have been useful. There is actually a link in the show notes below to the bug where a guy asked for support for that. Go and upvote it so maybe we can convince them for this being a good idea. All we need is actually just a few buttons. I am now, and let me just make this much less screen real estate because I will really just use those few pixels here. I am now at the same breakpoint, or well, the same place that my application crashed. And I can investigate again, going up. There we are. And this is the line that I want to go to. What I can do now is I can set a breakpoint here, and then I can go up here. And then I can say, bear with me, it's mind-boggling, reverse continue. So now I'm saying, execute the application backwards. So like, a movie that you record and play backwards, do that until you get to that breakpoint. And now I'm actually at that breakpoint. And I can show you here that I can actually go further back if I want to. I can go RN for reverse next. And you can see now I'll get up RN. There we are. Now I'll jump up to that line here. And be careful if you want to go one more line up, then you need to give focus up there again. That's why it would be so convenient if Qt Creator had proper support for this. Now I can go one step further up. See, that's reverse debugging. Now I've gone a bit back in time and I can go down here, F10, and this is where I really want to go in, so F11. So now I'm just stepping into, out and in again. And here we are now in the parent method, the one that I really wanted to go into and investigate what kind of value did it come to the conclusion that it should give out and that it didn't give out properly. Admit it, that was pretty cool, wasn't it? So, Memento style, Memento, whatever. I will now go to the very beginning of the show here and I'll show you how this all works from the command line. Because unfortunately, RR doesn't work out of the box with Qt Creator, but as you saw, we could make it work. So here is my command line for starting KWR. KWR minus minus auto minus login, and that will automatically log in and it will start the most recent dashlet and go to the crash. What I'll do now is that I'll just start it using RR. And now I will record my session. So I'm actually interacting with my application as I would until the point where I wanted to do the reverse debugging. This, it's time, given that it's crashing and given that it doesn't require any user interaction at all, it just did. But, well, let me try. RR, and then skip the auto login. Now comes the login dialog. I will click the login, and now it'll do the same thing as with the parameters. Now I recorded a session. In my file system, there is a lot of files that tells me that recorded what exactly happened during this. And then it's time to play it back. To play it back, I use the RR binary once again. And instead of specifying the binary as I did previously, I'll simply specify replay. So RR replay, and now it will start running the application again. But instead of interacting with me as a user for the user interface and other things, it will simply replay the events as it saw when it called into library functions during program execution. Do not get fooled by the parenthesis open RR parenthesis close here. You are now in a GDB, a modified GDB version. It's actually modified in the same way as your GDB is modified if you're debugging on an embedded device. There you, on your embedded device, you run a GDB stop, and that one is communicating to the full-blown GDB over here, and it's just over the TCP communication channel there, telling what is going on inside the application. That's the same thing here, except the stop is not an application running. It is a replay of the application that it recorded. Okay, I admit it. Low-level GDB is, I'm too old for that. So let's just quit it right away. See, I can't even figure out. Control D. Oh, there we are. I have an alias here called CRR, which will actually start up my RR with full path here. Replay, minus, minus, debugger, and then CGDB. And if I run CRR, it will feel just a bit more mature. I'm now playing back. It broke at the very first instruction. So I can put a breakpoint here in main now, for example, and then continue. And now I am running my application forward and until I will hit it or hit the breakpoint in main. It is a bit slow. It's a bit slower, at least, than regular running GDB. But now here I am at my breakpoint. And I can do N for next and RN for reverse next and C for continue and RC for reverse continue, RS for reverse step, and RF, R finish, for reverse finish, which means go to the start of the application. But that is how you work with it on the command line. But you didn't come to this video to see how to do it from the command line. You want to know how I did it when I ran it from within Qt Creator. And let me admit, I didn't invent all of this. There is actually a link below where I learned about this, but hey, I'm just condensing it for you. What I need to do now is to start that part of my application that was the server part of GDB, And I can do that by running RR again here, but this time specifying, please listen on port 50505. And then minus K means continue even after you are done with a session, because we might reconnect with another session. So RR server, now I started and it tells me you can start GDB like this, but I don't want to do that. I want to go inside of my Qt creator. Inside my Qt creator, I now want to start a debugging session that communicates with this server. So I'll go debug, start debugging, and then I'll attach to a running debug server. You can see I already bound that to a key. Very useful, do that yourself. And up comes this dialog here. It asks me for the kit, that is the configuration, and I'll just use the default because it is what I only have that one kit for running this application. The server port, that's 50505, the number that we got from over there. The local executable, I will have to specify where that one is. It would have been cool if I could just say current run settings, but that didn't work in my current version. Hey, a new version came out recently. I should check whether they fixed that bug in between. Otherwise, I just specify the complete full path for this this binary here. That is my KW. And I really don't need to specify anything else. If I had a few that I jumped between, I would have a drop down here with the set of recent configuration. Now I'll OK, and it will start my debugger, and it will actually run all the way to the end if it doesn't meet breakpoints and so on. There is a configuration for in the debugger setting for saying break at main if you want to do that, but you can see that it's now loading in the different, you can also see that down here, it's loading in the different DLLs that it's depending on. And now it actually hit that breakpoint going forward, and I could show you, if I didn't even bother, I could press F5 and F5 and F5 and F5. You just stopped me here, right? I told you that we would hit this one quite a few times before we actually hit it with the error condition. I just love how I'm jumping around in time in this time traveling episode here, because now I'll show you how I can actually also start my recording session from within Qt Creator. If you look on my screen here now, I can I'll show you a binary that, oh, binary, that's an exaggeration, a small shell script that I created. So first of all, I have RR specified with RR here because I did not have RR in my path, and let me just warn you about that. I initially just had this whole directory here, but if you go and look in that directory, you will notice that among a lot of other things, it has a binary called changemod. And that's not fun to have something completely changemod. It took me quite a while to figure out why my changemod all of a sudden didn't work anymore. So I do not have that in my path. I should, of course, have done a make install on RR, but never mind about that. I instead have this variable here, and I test whether I did remember to specify the binary. Then I kill all RRs, and that might be another reason for not calling it RR, because, well, I feel better about killing something with a complete path here. I kill them all, and I wait for them all to die, and that's simply because I would like to just redo it from within Qt Creator. So if there's already a server listening, I'll kill that one, and then I'll start a new one. Then I will record my application that I specified. And when I'm done with that, I will replay back. That's the server that we just saw. There's one more line in here let me just say, well, of course, you need to adapt the script unless you also happen to be called Blackie on your system. But there is this one line here. And what that does is that never, ever does RR nuke its own recordings. And they are pretty big. So I can just look here in this direct, not this directory, and okay, in here. Well, let's do a disk use here. And you can see that I already got 300 megabytes from three sessions. And they were really just starting up and crashing right away. So that's why I have this RM-RF. It's your own decision whether you dare doing that from a script. If you nuke your whole disk, do not come and claim money back from the recording. Well, never mind. That is the script. I can run this script to start recording and start the server once I'm done with the recording. And the final thing that I'm missing now is to run this script when I want to do that. But I also do want to run this script from within Qt Creator. So let me show you how I set that up. So back inside Qt Creator, I am going to show you a small trick that I've done many times before. In these, I'm simply going to external and configure. And what I'm doing here now is that I'm just creating a new record using RR. I set that up by saying add and so on. There is a few episodes already out there where I do this, so I'm not going to go into the detail. All I'm saying is that this is the executable and this is the parameter here so that I can specify it with different parameters. But I'll show you one final trick that makes this super nice, because now to run this, all I need to do is control K, X for run external command and space. Now it suggests those that I have in there already. You can see record using RR, so just RR, and there we are. And now it will start the application. I can log in as usual here. It'll run to the crash. And once it has gone to that crash site, it will launch the RR in replay mode as a server, and I'll control shift F5. It'll bring up this dialog that I already populated. I'll press OK. It will start loading all the symbols, and I'm ready to go back in time. And now we are at the very beginning of the plot, namely, how do you even install RR? Well, there's a link below, and there are some packages that you can install, but RR is really digging very deep into the stack. So better compile it with exactly the setup that you have. It is just git clone, CMake, miners, whatever, ninja flag, and then you are ready to go. And pretty easy. This was it for this episode. RR was one of the things that my coworker has been mocking me around with the most during the times I was a referee on the Windows side of the fence, because there, well, Visual Studio has something in the commercial version, but at least I never got to try it out. I already, in the few weeks I've been on Linux, I already used RR a couple of times to more easily get to crashes. There are, of course, always alternative ways of getting things, but sometimes using the right tool for the right problem is just the right thing to do. So with those final words, I hope you will enjoy it. And do give me your feedback in the comment how it worked out for you. And any suggestions for other episodes or other things I should be looking into, I'm always very interested in hearing that. I'm Jesper Pedersen from QTopia. Thank you very much.